kind of the goal of forming groups. Everyone was successful. Anyone have any issues? Nope. So what we're going to be doing pretty much for the rest of the course, anything that's group related, right, on Canvas, you guys will be coming up here. So did everyone have a chance to review class exercise 2 for this week? Yeah? All right. Who wants to come up here and volunteer first? Talk a little bit about the exercise. Yes. You know, the dates are off. By one, obviously, you know, the paper or whatever the submission will be. Yeah. So the dates may be off by a day. Which case, you know, if you're coming up here to present, obviously, it's on Tuesday or Thursday. Your submissions could be due Friday, right? The actual paper submission. But is anyone prepared to kind of talk about it? What you come up with?
About the exercise.
Yeah. Right? Basically, did you guys start researching the four industries? Okay. 4 degrees of competition, right? Explain how to embody type of competition. And provide an opinion. This is not something to be afraid of. You're providing an opinion about the industry. So would anybody like to come up here as a group? Talk about what they brought you about the price. Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty sure you guys should just have a general idea.
I have the rough draft.
Do you feel comfortable coming up here?
I do.
Okay, how about this? We'll save it for Tuesday. Come up here as a group. Everybody's going to drop their 2 cents, right? As a group. I hope you learn takeaways, insights, et cetera, et cetera. So it's really what I'm asking. Like, answer the questions, but also provide some insight, right? Don't regurgitate just textbook stuff, but you know, talk realistically. So Tuesday we'll do that, and then Thursday we have a class exercise with the next one, so we'll also do one with this. So just come up here for, I'll come up here for a long time, come up for a few minutes. Okay? Everybody say something, talk about it. Anybody here an introvert, don't like speaking in front of groups? Uncomfortable. All right, so we got this, we'll do that Tuesday, so be prepared. And whoever's in your group that's not here, let them know. This is what you're doing. And then for Thursday, we will save. Thursday, you really don't have to come up here talking about it. But you can if you're like, oh, this is. You have this. You guys started the building a business profile yet? No? Okay. We'll work on that. 1 minute speech, right? Tell me the name, industry, sector, locations, products, services, all of this. And then it says, as a class, we will vote for the best businesses presented in the class. Those top businesses will form the basis of a more detailed business program. So we'll kind of filter from there. But be prepared to do a 1 minute speech. By 1 minute, I mean 1 minute per person. Okay? I want everybody to speak. I'll just have a speaker. How's that sound?
Sounds good.
Sounds good. Alright. How's your other classes going?
Actually, I want to be one of my communications classes. And based off what we're doing, I actually like the setup I have this semester because I can relate to every single class to the other one.
Yeah.
So I actually thought it was pretty good, especially for my class as well.
That's awesome. Yeah, I mean, honestly, if you can't relate every other class to the other one, I think that's kind of what we're here for.
It makes it easier too because I kind of like take paper from here and I use it for the other class.
Yeah. It says something about, you know, certain thinking. We're here to connect dots, right? We're not here to have boring lectures, things like that. We're here to connect dots, and that's the quality of your thoughts, not my thoughts. The point is to take whatever we're learning in any class and take it further and ask some curious questions that you have. Don't hold your tongue, right? No question is stupid. Curious mind is the greatest mind.
It's helpful too.
Yeah, and Niccolo Machiavelli.
I just bought a book. Well, I bought it from a book for a class or something. And I actually find a lot of things from here actually apply to business too.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, a lot of CEOs read that book and carry it around with
you. For real?
Yeah. Sun Tzu, Machiavelli.
I just got that one too. I also got the 50 Laws of Power is coming too.
Yeah, Robert Greene, 50 Laws of Power. Anybody read The Prince, Machiavelli?
A quick 2 weeks read.
50 Laws of Power, anyone read that, came across it? Interesting books, right? About competition, how to get ahead, how this game of life is set up. There really is a game and a lot of distinction. So it's really like who's winning the game, right? Who's winning, who's not winning, who's participating, who's on the sidelines just watching, who's playing. But think of all of this as sort of a game you're trying to win, right? A lot of people competing. We're going to continue economics, try to make economics as interesting as possible. I know sometimes it can be sort of a dry topic because I don't think it was as understood as other topics in this. But very, very important. Any questions before we begin? Anything new happening out in the field of business anyone want to talk about? Personal life, jobs, career.
Actually, you want to do this.
Go ahead.
It's just our resume is becoming irrelevant.
They're still very useful, right? So you're going to say, well, how did business measure you, right? Try to assess who you are as a person. I mean, they obviously, businesses do research. They're going to look at all your social media, go on your LinkedIn, all your stuff, right? Because they won't have that stuff. Number two, when you come in, you actually apply, and they're like, hey, we want you to actually go on our website and apply. We think you could be a person of interest. They're going to do personality assessment, right? They're going to say, like, I get it, you're smart. You went to school, you got your relationship. Just like the other 10,000 people we look on LinkedIn, 10,000 people also apply. So how do you distinguish yourself? They'll do personality profiles, which I used to do for companies, industrial organizational psychology. And I ask you a series of questions, right? All these tricky questions, redundant questions, questions, similar questions in different ways. You're trying to figure out insight. Do you have the fortitude for the job? Are you too nice? Too aggressive, or too lax, all these different things. You gotta figure out if you're the right person for the job, right? So that's one of the ways to go about selecting past the resume. I think a resume is a good introduction. Typically, resumes and cover letters, you wanna be super specific about the job you're applying for. You can't be too general, right? People that's catering to that position. which could be frustrating. The single family jobs you're gonna apply for that you're gonna get rejected. Eventually, I think they may be irrelevant and there may be another way to recruit people, right? I think they'll get more creative and be like, we're going to bring in a set amount of people who just apply and we're going to do some exercise or something. Right? AI, artificial intelligence, or something. Anybody actively applying for jobs or just kind of focusing on schools, right? Besides people as well? Yes, what are you
applying
for? Are you marketing major?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so I've been struggling trying to get an internship.
Yeah. How many of you applied to?
Like four.
Okay. To like taper everything down and cater specifically?
Yeah, I mean, I've looked at my resume, I've shown it to people, I'm just going to make that stand out and like help them understand.
Yeah. Okay, good luck. What do you want to do in marketing specifically? Internships are great. I think it's actually a good way to kind of get your foot in the door. When I first started, I got an internship. It's like a junior undergrad. I got an internship with Blackstone Group. I may have to tell you this first day. And they kept me. I moved up and did a lot of like research for them. Had a cool office down on Mission Wacker. Blah, blah, blah. And I said, okay, this is good. Everything that glitters not gold. And eventually everything becomes redundant, right? You get the new car after 3 months, it's just not never stops, which we'll talk about in economics. So from beyond that, I was like, I don't want a boss, right? I don't want nobody to tell me anything to do in this job. So I left and started my business and I started an MBA program at the same time. That's a little bit of my story. Clifton Strengths, the codes, they're supposed to be emailed to me today, this evening. They may be emailed directly to you.
I don't see it.
Okay, so if they're emailed directly to you, there's no reason to email me. Just go ahead and access it and start working on the assessments. Sounds good? All right, we talked a little bit about private property, capitalism, communism, non-capitalism, those things. I think I may have asked this on Tuesday, but what do we think economics is exactly? I think somebody gave a sort of a short definition. Yes? Think about it, you made a choice. You made a decision. I don't know if you made it, maybe you're just going to help with what your family told you to do. I don't know if you made an actual real independent choice. But you're here, right? In this real world right now, you are here. Think about it, you made a choice, and we all make a choice. you're gonna leave here, you're gonna make another choice. Every day, you're gonna make another decision. Why did you buy the car you have? Why did you get here to school the way that you got here? Why did you buy those shoes? Why did you buy that hoodie? Why did you buy that laptop? Why did you get that phone? Why did you build your new thing? You made decisions, right? And every day it costs you money, because you could do another decision. Someone could say, hey, I bought $1,000 pair of shoes. Interesting. Why'd you buy $1,000 pair of shoes? Right? So how much is your income right now? How many employees? Somebody made a decision, right? And that's on them, right? That's their decision, that's their life. But you did have an option to make that decision. We have options. But we only have a limited amount of options. We have the unlimited amount of needs and wants. Our needs and our wants are unlimited, but the resources are there, are limited. They only produce a certain amount of those shoes. Not everybody can get them. They only produce a certain amount of this or that, not everybody can get them. So if you think about it, that's where the economics start. So if you can keep that principle, you're like, man, why is the price of this? Well, maybe it's scarcity, right? They have a limited amount of this. They feel comfortable. This is the price that meets the demand. Now we get it. There's other factors. Brand name, right? The value of the brand. All the different other factors. But really is supplying you with scarce goods so that you make a decision and either choose one thing or choose another. So you can think about economics. That's what all starts. So you can talk about supply and demand, but all starts with choices and decisions. Decisions is not just you, it's individuals, decisions as companies, decisions as governments, right? All types of players in the game. So degrees of competition, right? Remember we said we live in, I guess, a quasi-free market economy, right? One of the most free market economies. Not perfect by any means, no economy is. But it's decent, right? Capitalism is what we call it. And so in a pure capitalistic free market economy, right? Idealistic world, you get many competitors selling virtually identical products. You get a lot of people out there selling stuff. So when a lot of people are out there selling stuff, you have a lot of different options, choices. And the businesses know that. Therefore, they will have to start to compete on what's the most comfortable price to promote it to. So that you actually buy this and not that. Right? That's the beauty of having a big, big, robust peer economy, right? It'd be good for us as consumers. It'll lower the price. Create a lot of variation. And you can see this if you go on Amazon. Right? Amazon, unfortunately, is not unfortunate, but fortunately, it's like a disruptor. It's basically saying we're going to put every, not everything, but a lot of stuff that's out there into one platform for people to source something. And now all the other, all these other companies that produce all this stuff, they know that their stuff could be on it. So they know, like, hey, it's a lot of competition. But originally, it was really, really expensive, right? It's people that have these options. Now, the price is going down, right? It's easy. They have to compete amongst each other, right? Now, if you go on something like Alibaba, have I ever been on Alibaba, AliExpress, anything? Yes? Like, what's the price of that? What are you going to get? I don't know, 3 months. That's the caveat. That's the catch. It's not like it's not a catch. Maybe you go on eBay, but it's kind of good over the road. You can negotiate. Hey, you want $15 or you need $5 for it. I'll send it back. $8. Right? More stuff. Because everybody has to compete. And so it's really good when you have an open market so that everybody can compete. That people don't get ripped off. So all these companies can try to lower their costs. Now, when you don't have that sort of peer economy, right? You can have monopolistic degrees of competition. Right? Many competitors send differentiated profits. But think of this more of monopolies just all together in common. Right? Here they don't really talk about degrees of competition, but really, what is a monopoly if we look at economics? What does that mean? Many competitors selling differentiated products, right? They're not selling identical products, which would be robust, like they were looking for a specific thing, thousands of percent. But now we got many competitors selling differentiated products. So they spread out the type of different products. So now you have a choice, but the choices are different. It's not exactly what you're looking for. You have some sort of alternative. You may not want it that alternative. But now they kind of force you to make a choice on a particular problem, right? They shape your view, they shape your choice. And we can think of this even when we think of like maybe, but why do people buy, what's the cost of what you pay?
I didn't get them for myself. They were a gift. But my social status went up after I got them. So that's why you get it. Because people value, well, I guess they used to value the brand that Kanye West was associated with. I don't know if I should wear them anymore.
Yeah. So think about it. Your behavior and what you purchase was shaped by some outside forces, right? You may not realistically, if Kanye West was not associated with that brand, have bought that shoe, right? Let's say it was just some random Joe Blow shoe you saw on the internet. Probably would have skipped it. Thus, they knew that to market a particular artist with that particular brand, Adidas, Kanye West has his own brand, I understand it too. That they shape your opinion on what to buy that particular product, right? They shape it. I don't know if you necessarily bought it just because you like it. Because your formation of associating Kanye West with that thing probably caused you to finally make a purchase. He purchased it at that price for social value, right? They say social value, but hey, do you really like the shoe? No, that's kind of right. So this is what happens when we get firms trying to differentiate products, but also kind of monopolizing, capitalizing on that to force us to buy particular type of things. But we inherently were not looking for it at the beginning. But think of that, they've hacked their brands. They've hacked, especially with social media, our brands have been hacked to buy things we probably don't like, and hence why we don't wear it. That's why we probably get rid of it very, very soon. Doesn't have lasting power, right? You shape people to create impulses and quick decisions. Here, oligopoly is a handful of competitors selling products that can be similar or different. Right? You think of the big tech companies. Right? You think of Samsung and Apple. How many people on the iPhone in this class? Something other than iPhone, Samsung. Oh, what'd you get? So you're the only person, nobody else, right? Think about it. So you're like, man, why so many limited options? Right, this is it. Right, and that might kind of, economically, that might kind of be unfair. What kind of other phones we could have if we had 1,000 phenomenal companies making phenomenal phones? Back, man, I want a phone that's absolutely customized to what I need it for, right? website, 13 Pro, right? Mm-hmm. 250 cents gave by 512. Right, that's not many options because everybody can get them. You say, oh, maybe I catered it through the apps. I made it specifically on the app. Maybe that's the way of looking at it. But really, we got an oligopoly happening, right? Just a handful of companies driving the market, driving people's choices. You make the choice to buy it, only a handful of companies probably dictated that choice to buy it. And if we got monopoly, which was already discussed, someone asked, right? Single producer dominating industry, leaving no room for competitors. What's an example of a company that's a monopoly or been a huge?
This was my part, you know, I heard that. I unfortunately for us, I knew, but back in like the 1930s and 40s, the biggest oil companies actually split up into five different oil companies that are not completely threatening. It's the oil that we all use still to this day.
The person who owned it was John D. Rockefeller, right? The name of the company was Standard Oil.
Yeah,
right?
I believe so.
So John D. Rockefeller was the wealthiest person. Could be argued some people really did. Past history, we can't really verify. But as far as modern times, John D. Rockefeller, wealthiest person ever. Adjusted for inflation, more wealthy than Elon Musk ever was. And he had Standard Oil, and they were a monopoly controlling oil. When you think of with oil, you're like, well, oil's just not gas. That's a big one, right? It's not just to make vehicles, man. It's for machines. What else does oil produce?
We use it to cook.
Yeah, like people use it to cook. So it's things for food and eating. What else? What's a big one? It's drinking happening right now. What's that? What's your hint?
Bottle.
What kind of bottle?
Plastic.
Plastic. Right? Petrochemicals. So you need oil for plastics. Right? How many plastics are there? Anyway, the government determined Rockefeller was too big, and I don't even know what they did.
You know, it's because they bought up multiple oil companies in the state. And since one popped out, you buy the state's
government. Yeah, so you eliminate your competition that way. And I guarantee you, if you had a business and you say, I got competitors and I have enough money to buy them out, you'd probably do the same thing. Right? So it goes to show that none of these economies are perfect. Because you're like, man, it's really unfair. You're preventing other people from entering the market because it might cost a ton of money to enter that market. Whereas the average person never gets that money. And you might buddy up and lobby with the government because you have so much power and influence. You could buy votes, essentially, right? You could buy, get people in office. You're not going to allow the people to. You're going to do all types of tricks and laws to stop people. But what they did with Rockefeller is they broke it up. And honestly, what they did probably didn't matter. They broke it up into smaller companies, still owned by Rockefeller. So like it doesn't make any at the end of the day.
But the best option.
Yeah, but think about it. Rockefeller
is his family still around?
His family's probably one of the most powerful families ever. You ever heard of the United Nations? His family created the United Nations. Literally. Right?
That was just an organization, I think, of business too.
Not a business. He created the organization. Right? Son, his grandson, actually, was one of the ones who really, really took the fight, but his son. Really created, established by working with heads of governments to try to form, to create a one world government. One kind of dollar. Obviously, we don't have that, but that was the mission to create. You can say that's evil, or maybe it's good. Like, hey, we all need a platform to discuss our issues. Different countries. This is a great idea.
Prevented a lot of wars from starting.
Yes. So, it's just depending on how you look at it, right? There are conspiracy theories like that. One world government, if you look at another beauty right. Oh, good. We have a platform for people to communicate, to prevent wars, prevent other issues. Yes. Rockefeller, you ever heard of the University of Chicago? Rockefeller founded the University of Chicago. Talk about power, it's real power. I think they bought land too for the UN. You know, United Nations, and I can get sidetracked, but United Nations, their headquarters is in New York. Anyone ever been there? New York? Yeah, so you figure it's not government. The government has no authority. The federal government has an authority of just that parcel of land in New York. It's essentially its own government. So if you go in the building, you're not on federal land. It's almost essentially like if you go in the Native American land. The federal government has no jurisdiction. Right? So if you have a military, you can't go in there. If you have pollution, you can't send. Anyway, so a very, very powerful institution. So yes, all right, did not get sidetracked, but yeah, Standard Oil, single producer dominating industry. Another one in the 90s was Microsoft, Bill Gates, okay? Had to go to speak in front of Congress, accused of being a monopoly because of Windows. Anybody use Windows or anything Windows? Here. You kind of say, what's your other option? Maybe iOS or whatever. Mac OS, right? I think there's very little options. Who else is using? Besides Mac OS and Windows, who in this class is using anything else besides those two? What are you using? Once again, Apple, Google, Microsoft. Who else? Who is using something besides Chrome, Mac OS? Once again, right? Google. Huh? Yeah, but I'm saying just
browser.
Yeah, think of like the operating system, right? Not just a browser. You know, this kind of problem. Actually, what operating system is working at the computer itself? Is it Windows? Are you using Windows?
It's just so difficult because we have no options.
Yeah.
Only handful of companies have control over all these devices.
So think about that. So as we learn, try to learn through business, pay attention to this. You're like, man, as you answer your questions and come up here to present next week and talk about that, you're looking like, hey, this industry is really controlled by two major, major players, right? How difficult is that for us to become big? Maybe for you future entrepreneurs. Hey, I got this great idea, Professor Ross. And I'm like, hey, did you analyze the market you're trying to get into? How difficult is it to get in? Just to get in. Beyond getting in, how difficult is it to grow? You may be competing against sort of maybe something like this, or maybe something like this, and like, man, we didn't last. Why? The other guys, they just lower the price of their product. Why would somebody buy our stuff for expensive when people offer the same exact stuff cheap? Right? Therefore, your business will lose a ton of money and potentially fail. So this is just the gist of it, right? It's not to get too complicated, but just like just trying to climb the tree before we start going down to the branches, right? Just understand the principles of looking at this. So you can look at this for business, you can look at this as governance. When you read the news, you completely understand what exactly is happening with the government. Like, this is the U.S. And natural monopoly. What we said with Rockefeller. Hey, your business gets so big. So big. Your business gets so big and you have so much money now. Are you going to let people just compete? Starting to creep up, they got a really good idea. They might take away some of our consumers. Let's offer them X amount of dollars and buy them out. Right? So, therefore, we own them too. We own that too. Eventually, you keep doing that, you get so big, who can compete? Everybody's, you offer a company who's maybe uncertain of themselves. $100 million, like we just started 6 months ago. Well, here's $100 million. Well, buy the company. Okay, sure. $100 million sounds great. If you keep doing that, then you won't have any competitors. Your competitors are way, way down there who have no chance of ever really being competitive. So back to the human behavior and choices and decisions. We said that, okay, we have unlimited amount of wants and needs. All of us want so much, right? Want. We're gonna constantly want, whatever. So eventually we gotta make choices on what we actually do. What is the amount of that thing being offered? How much of it is being offered? Which we would call the supply curve, right? Nothing new for everyone's technical knowledge. And how many people actually want that particular thing? That's called the demand curve, right? And when they meet in the middle, they'll call it equilibrium. The perfect balance of where what is being offered versus what is being wanted meets each other. Right? If you can figure that out, you can figure, like, I only need X amount of this. Is anything more this way? People don't want anything beyond that. So think of it very simply. When you go to TJ Maxx, Marshall's, right? And then you see the regular stuff on the clothing rack, and you see a clearance section. What's the clearance section all about? What's that?
Just to get rid of the supplies.
Get rid of the stuff that people didn't want, right? By demand of it at that price. It's like, oh, okay. Right? So we call that just you know, just anything that's old, right? We call it inventory or whatever you want to call it.
Just getting rid of the surplus.
So yeah. You got too much, right? You got surplus. I have a dozen. So, and now they got a lower price. Like, oh, okay, well, people didn't want it at this price. We got a lower so we can get rid of it. Now on a much broader scale, GDP, right? Which is total final goods and services produced within the nation's physical boundaries over a given period of time. I think we someone maybe answer what GDP was? Like in a simple way. Is that you, Connor?
Is it not a truck?
Yeah.
Right. Isn't it just like how much a nation like makes and like revenue or profit?
It's all of it, right? All the goods and services produced in the country, how much incomes have increased, right? Minus subtracting all the debt that we owe, right? You would see how much we've grown over time. But what encompasses it is the business cycle, right? How many companies have been created in that amount of time? What if they do? Okay, we've increased the number of businesses, or the existing businesses have gotten bigger. How many people did they hire? Most people working at these places, right? And then we look at the price level, so the supply and demand. And then the productivity is the relationship between the production of goods and services and the resources required to produce them. So remember, once again, we have a limited amount of resources, but we still have to produce things that people want. So if we have too many, we have a surplus, too little, we have a deficit. Business cycle, periodic contraction and expansion of the economy. Think of the business cycle. Anyone ever heard of like product life cycle?
That would be like durability wise, or it's trendy?
No, just like the trajectories of like a product over time. Right? So think of it this way, before we get into contractions, expansions. Products do well in different certain periods of time. Governments do well, or they do very poorly at different specific times. Businesses also do well or do poorly at specific times based on what's happening in the economy, right? I did lose all that money, probably because of the economy at a particular time. Tesla vehicles, although they're great, many people cannot afford them. The people aren't working enough, and even more people can't afford them, so they have options to make a different choice of a cheaper vehicle, even though Teslas are cool. So it's a cycle. So we always have business cycle, right? Business goes up, goes down. No business is constantly going up. That's why you look at the stock market, lost money today, probably you went up by 2%, right? Never, ever, just keeps constantly going up. Now, it may go up over time, like we show, like the Dow, but you are going to experience some kind of cycles, right? So we got a contraction in economics, so it's basically the economic turndown. Things are going bad, interest rates are going up, people are not taking out loans, people aren't buying things, businesses aren't hiring as much, therefore people don't have money to buy more stuff. Right, recession is marked by a decrease in the GDP for 2 consecutive quarters, 4 quarters within a year for any business or any government, right? Call them fiscal quarters. Right? So when it happens, has potentially half of the year if our GDP has not increased for, say, 6 months at least, then we are officially in a recession, right? That doesn't happen that often. A recession doesn't happen that frequently. But a recession is big, huge. Because you think of even the major corporations must have took a hit for us not to increase our production over 6 months. Yeah. Not just all the small businesses, but those major players we just talked about, they must have taken a hit. And if they supply a lot of the jobs in the country, guess what? Employment, unemployment will be high, and then less people will be out working, less people work, less productive the country is. Less productive the country is, more the GDP decreases and go down. And guess what too? You said the government, federal government is the biggest employer. They hire the most people and they spend the most money with your tax dollars. Guess what? Federal government doesn't receive tax dollars as much. You don't have income. You don't have a job. Places don't exist no more, or the different companies are letting people go. And then the federal government shrinks too. So now they can't buy as much stuff as they used to. And things really, really scale. And then a depression is just long, long lasting depression. Anybody familiar with like the Great Depression? Anybody tell me about the Great Depression? Looks like it. cycles. So it doesn't last forever. It constantly goes up and down. The Zed cycle. All of these things. Up and down. But it goes up. Right? All it's going to go up. It just depends on where you are right now at this specific time, how bad things are. Now if things are bad, some people are going to mope about it and cry about it. Oh my gosh, I lost the business and all of that. So it depends on your perspective. Some people are like, man, the land is bad. I hope it gets worse. Why? I'm trying to buy everything cheap. I'm trying to make it expensive. Right? I'm trying to buy that building for cheap. Because I know once again, it'll be worse than that. So just really, those are opportunities, right? Opportunities. Always be opportunistic. Right? Because everything's always bad. Life's bad. But we're all going to die. I don't know how you look at it, but no. Seize the day. Today is all that matters. Now this matters. And then expansion, period of long economic growth and high employment. Right? The U.S. had that. We've had great expansion. Think past the 1970s when I think Nixon was in office. And we said, hey, you know what? Fort Knox, where we used to keep all this gold, we're no longer going to keep you around. Why? We're not going to base our dollar off of gold. We're going to create fiat currency. What's it based off of? It wasn't backed by. Really nothing. Right? So we used to have sort of a gold standard, as we call it, right? We would always back our dollar up for a bad time with gold. That's why some people still like when things are bad, the price of gold goes up. Right? So the economy is bad, price of gold goes up, economy is great, gold is cheap. Right? And that also dictates people investment being part of your portfolio. So I got stocks, bonds, or I got precious metals, I got gold, silver, platinum, etc. Just in case, I know that at some point we'll go bad. Again, this is just how it functions. It's depending on where you are in the cycle. But eventually we'll have strong, strong economic growth with AI, with all the TikTok opportunities, with social media, everybody can start a business at some point. Wonderful. Right? Maybe before Uber, Lyft gets to hail a taxi and wait outside. I remember I was in college and I wrote a business plan for just like Uber. That's before. Their own cars to drive people around instead of waiting for a taxi. And you know, I presented it to some investors, stuff like this. And then the next thing I knew, before I could like get the money, the security like started to buy vehicles and have a platform. No, really, Uber is about that platform, right? It's about that app, it's about the technology. That was gonna require a lot of money. But anyway, so that didn't work out for me. Uber can't work. So I missed it. But anyway, Uber creates strong economic growth, right? Employment. Somebody can say, I got a car, I'm working another job. I can hook up with Uber, right? I hook up with Uber Eats, Lyft, deliver food or something like that. So Uber, we're kind of entering like the Uber of the world now, right? Everybody can use something they think the business would have to create some sort of economic opportunity. And TikTok and all that, there'll be something beyond that that'll help people to solve. We'll all be business owners or something. Which may be good, which may be bad. Because everything's a cycle. Right? The stock market of any company, like, oh, high, low, last month was great, this month bad. Our entire economy was just a dead cycle. Anybody ever apply for unemployment? Everything we have as an option. Percentage of people in the labor force over age of 16 who do not have jobs and are seeking employment. Now, who could Google current unemployment rate? Who could Google it for me really quick? Current unemployment rate in the U.S.
3.7%.
Right, so they say 4% unemployment, right? Once again, government puts out data. We always say, how much you trust the government? Because you got to look at this context of the data and say, well, oh, this is only for people who reported actively looking for a job in the last 30 days, 60 days, 90 days. They don't include everybody else who just haven't reported anything. Just don't have time, right? The really unemployment rate is way beyond that. It's always way beyond that. But that's just the statistical data of people who reported it. So. friction unemployment is when it's possible to find better jobs, but people don't want those jobs. You know, there's a lot of jobs in this country that people don't want, that immigrants typically do, right? They want the opportunity to make some money and earn a simple job.
They're saying they're taking the jobs.
Yeah, right? But the people don't want the jobs in the first place, that's why the jobs aren't available, right? Structural unemployment for a longer term, as skills are no longer relevant. Who can give me an example for that?
Construction.
New skills, new skills. Like, think of some areas. Oh, yes.
Chimney cleaners.
Yeah, you can say chimney cleaners. VCR repairman. Right? It's going to be something. Yes.
I don't know what the job was, but the people on the Wolf of Wall Street, they make those calls to buy certain
stocks.
Yeah, certain shares and companies, and you could just run on my phone and say,
yeah, think about it, right? The people didn't have the automation, right? We didn't have the technology to put that in everybody's hand to see it, so you get people calling, hey, you gotta get in on this new company, that's the next thing, the greatest thing to happen. Okay, tell me about it, right? Particularly you call them doctors and lawyers, people with some money, they don't have time to make that decision, do all the research. That's what a good salesman, a Wolf of Wall Street would do, right? But they were selling penny stocks. You could buy penny stocks in the hope that, think of even cryptocurrency, right? You look at some of it, and you're like, oh, what's it worth? It's worth 0.0000003 cents, right? Like, I'm hoping to go one day to 1 cent. So you're like, I'll be rich. Think of that happening with GameStop, right? GameStop is super cheap. Dollars, but if you own like a million shares, it's a lot of money, right? So yeah, those guys eventually were obsolete. Technology came around. Now we all can look up whatever we want. Right? We have the information. The information is free. Right? Think of even automatic checkouts at the grocery store, right? And we say, hey, customer. We used to just want you to put this on the conveyor belt and this and all of that, scan it through, blah, blah, blah. Like, now we want you to do that. Do it yourself. We're going to save some money. Hopefully we save some money because those machines are expensive. Is it really worth? Is it really worth at the end of the day, on it? Yeah, maybe the machines are too expensive. Cost of machines versus just paying somebody an hourly wage. And then cyclical unemployment, layoffs during recession. Right? The government does this too. It lays people off when things are bad. My brother works for the EPA, so he got laid off during COVID. Obviously, you know, a lot of the government employees got laid off. With the hopes that, hey, you'll be back in hopefully 6 months. months, hopefully, we'll get right back on. But for right now, we just got a furlough, you were giving some time off. And is seasonal unemployment job loss related to time of year? Like what? Give me an example.
Christmas.
Yeah, like, man, we got a high demand for Christmas stuff out, high demand for Thanksgiving stuff. What we got to do, we're going to hire all these people to at the end of the year. We got to scan all of our inventory, right? So people should come in with inventory, scanning, all that stuff. Talk about inflation, average prices across the economy, which is really just about the dollar. Consumer price index evaluates the change in the weighted average price of goods and services that an average consumer buys each month. These don't really maybe not prepared. Not actually supposed to. All right, now here's your class exercise for chapter two. Research four industries past and present that represent four degrees of competition, monopolies, et cetera, et cetera. We'll have that ready for Tuesday. We'll briefly get into chapter three really quick, and then we can just have a few discussions. Any questions so far about economics?
With companies purposely set a price for all of them to do?
Oh, you mean like kind of conspire with one another or something like that?
Kind of video game companies. The price used to be from $20 to $6 and now it's $30 to $70 in every single video game. And somehow all the companies. PlayStation, Xbox, Nintendo as well. A lot of the companies switch from the $6 for video games to $70 an hour. And I wouldn't say it's just because they all have major consoles. I'd say it's because they all agreed that $70 was the best price for the consumers.
Okay, so the price went up by about $10 for new games. Yeah, I mean, okay, then there's some business, right? Remember we said, whoever moves first generally is going to be the biggest. Because whoever moves first, people with money, they're like, oh man, this is going to take off. Not my investment. Right? People with all this money want to invest. They want to get the next best thing. So Amazon started first with the idea, now they're the biggest. Yeah, there might be some other platforms around, but they're not Amazon. Right? What's the benefit of not moving first? Yeah, right? Now you get time to observe. You're like, I don't want it. That's kind of risky. But we observe, and guess what? People start buying it still at $70. The rest of the companies in that industry are going to say, yo, we will replicate and imitate what the big guy is doing. It works, right? So typically how it works with Apple, Google, all these, like, okay, who's going to move first, Apple, Amazon, or Google? You see one phone come out with the features, guess what? Google has similar features. It's just a little different, right? Just change it. Don't want to do the exact thing. And then Samsung is sort of the same stuff, right? Or you'd be like, oh, man, Apple's 6 months behind the Samsung phone. I already had that. But typically, they all follow each other. Kind of what I'm getting to, right? They all follow each other, but they wait to see the response from the market. Back to economics, the response of the human behavior. People buying it from that, or they're not. If they're not, then we know we're going to wait, we're not going to do what they want, because they make a very bad choice. They're not going to pay for it, they put a lot of money into it. So yes, it is the following of any business. So if you got a restaurant business, here's an example. Drive down Harlem Avenue and you see two gas stations across the street from each other. And you look at the prices. Okay. Or one may say, and lower the price. Like, oh, that's interesting. You look at the little fine, oh, with the car wash. Right? Kind of, right? So you might go there. People might not look at the fine print and be like, oh, I'm getting this amount, but you're still paying some price. The point is, they wait to see what each other is going to do, right? They wait to also look at the guy down the street. Anybody that's close, they're looking at that so that they follow suit. So, to answer your question, whoever moved first on that saw the response in the market that people are still going to buy it at that price. Everybody else says, we're going to do that too. Does that make sense? So yes, in business there is high imitation. There's a high need to imitate the bigger person or the first mover so that you can see the response of the market. McDonald's versus Burger King, Taco Bell, KFC, all this stuff. You're all going to switch it up, maybe make it a little bit different and call it by a different name, but essentially they're doing the exact same thing, asking each other. We can start off a little bit with chapter 3, and then we'll wrap it up. But yes, please be prepared to stay, come up here and talk. Arian Gallegos, are you? They reached out to me, so make sure you're the academic service success. Very impressive. Make sure you talk to them. All right? I think they want to make sure you're in class and stuff. Should have been making sure. When was the last time you were here?
Thursday. I just missed Tuesday.
This Tuesday?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll make sure I shoot the next email about it.
Yeah.
Alright, so what's the point of this class, right? What's the point of all this? This is all cool, but what's the point? The point of any of your business classes is really about what's the quality of your thoughts. Different students, you all think differently. But the point of it is, what is the quality of your thoughts? Yes, you have thoughts. We all have thoughts. Congratulations. What's the quality of those thoughts? How are you thinking about things that are being taught? Right? So that you make great decisions. So that you look at alternatives. So you don't just become a cog in a wheel that you think outside the box, right? So that you could be successful. Whatever it is you're trying to do, you could be successful. So you're like, well, how do you define success? Success is not the genius person. The richest people in the world are C students, not A's. Why? So you just need the bare minimum to pass. Why? I'm too busy making, I'm trying to make a billion. Say maybe the A's don't get me where I'm trying to get. And maybe they do. Right? Maybe they do. Maybe the A's get you into Harvard. You're like, oh, see student, good luck, you're not getting to Harvard. Right? The point is figure out what you're trying to do and start executing with a good strategy, a good plan. Do you have a plan? Or are you just kind of floating by? Right? The person who plans best wins. He who plans wins, right? Now, the other stuff, the social forces, I get it, you guys are young, you probably still have a lot of social force. Right, when you get a little bit older, kind of finish up still. But, you don't care about people. You don't care about the social force, right? You've already been to that. You have to worry about that stuff. Become a little bit more who you're supposed to be. But the point is, as you get older, you really, really got a plan. What's your strategy? What's your plan? So here in chapter 3, we're going to talk about strategic thinking, executing, right? Pulling the trigger on things when it needs to be pulled. employees would trigger off. Are you realistic? Are you idealistic? Are you living in reality, or are you living in some dreamlike world in your head? Right? Reality is today, the dream is tomorrow. So the more you focus on today, with the information you have today, the better off you'll be. Instead of focusing on some dream in the future. Whether the dream happens or not, who knows? Most of us don't, or it happens different than what we thought. Us to focus on reality today. Right? And some influencing your relationship. That's what college is about. Relationship building. Networking. Right? You'll learn more from each other, maybe learn more from your professors or any of these classes. But that only happens if you build relationships. It only happens if you communicate. Only happens if you actually do something. You have to do something other than just come to class and sit there. Like, what are you actually doing outside? Because everybody's doing things. What's on top? All right. I think for the boxes, what they're trying to say is people who think strategically, right? Strategic thinking, executing, influencing relationship. Six times as likely to be engaged at work for strategic thinkers, 7.8% more productive in a row than executors, three times as likely to have an excellent quality of life. People who influence people, and six times as likely do what they do best every day. The people who build relationships. So this is extremely important. Quality of life is important. Once again, thinking about your thoughts, the quality of your thoughts. Hey, Professor Ross, I want to win tomorrow at that game. I want to win. So I'm focused on winning. Like, oh, man, that's you're focused on something you don't have any control over. You don't have any control over if you win. Right? What you got control over is if you perform your best. That's it. So it's how you think. Changing the way how you think strategically. Right? You don't have the money right now. But can you get it? Yeah, you can. Absolutely. Hey, you guys can all be billionaires. At least multi-million. It's just really how creative are you thinking about what it is you're trying to do. How creative have you got? And it's not the most intelligent person, it's the person who just reacts to change. Right? Hey, Professor Ross, I want to make $50,000 coming out of college or $60,000. I'm like, yeah, doing that job? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, well, what about the quality of life for that job? Like, how they start off, they work like 80 hours a week. Interesting. 80 hours a week. So you trade your time for money. So you just trade time. You know you can't get time back. One day you wake up, you're over. The point is that job going to provide you an excellent quality of life. And those are some other factors besides the dollar. Right? Hey, Professor Ross, I couldn't get that job. I couldn't get more work together. Like, did you shoot people emails? Did you communicate? You know, nobody knows you exist unless you communicate. You don't exist. Okay? Just another thing. If you don't stand out and communicate, email, talk, you know, go to these events they have at school. Reach out for internships. Okay? Once again, quality of your thoughts, not the quantity. We all think a lot. What's the quality of your thoughts? You have excellent thoughts, and now you're trying to get better thoughts. No one's excellent. It's all trying to get better. And productivity. This one was for people who execute, right? So yeah, you can't think too much. People will overanalyze and never do anything. Because you're too busy thinking too much. You're never gonna get it perfect. So it's not gonna happen. It's not meant to be there. It's meant to make a decision and go off that, right? Eventually you have to act. Please act on something. Execute something. Just think about it. Writing up some formula for 6 years and they're like, oh, okay, they don't even do that anymore. Capitalize on the time. Yeah, that's how you be more productive. And this applies to all walks in life, right? More productive at a job, productive as a student. Do you have a plan? You know you can make this stuff easy for you, right? The workflow could be very quickly. If you have a plan, if you have a strategy. Sometimes when I was, I think I told you, when I was in MBA, I got my MBA here, right? International business. And I was like, man, I gotta make this money back. I had a scholarship, I was like, I gotta make some money back. But coming to school, wasting my time, blah, blah, blah. And I sold everybody the books. I made like $30,000 over 2 years. I made a lot of money. But why did I do that? Because I'm like, well, because nobody else is. This is just me. You know what I'm saying? I had to execute something I thought was better for me. And it actually worked out. Why did it work out? Because I can help everybody get the book for cheap. Whether I paid, wait a minute. I felt like I was doing justice. Right? We were at a nice traditional Roman Catholic school, and we're Roman Catholic, so maybe it might have been a little bit of unethical behavior for the trustees. But I had to make a decision, regardless, right? So I did what I did. The point is, you gotta have a plan, you gotta have a strategy, you gotta be able to execute that strategy. He who does not plan will lose. It's just that simple. If you read more about that, you will in the prints, right? Or something to do with things. So, what makes a CEO, right? Or a CFO, a CMO, Chief Marketing Officer, Chief? Why are these people at the top? They're only at the top because they make good choices. They don't make their choices. Everybody, man, what makes a good CEO? Decision maker. Why do we look at the guy as president? No, we just kind of like, we think he'll make a good decision. Right? That's really what it's about. Yes, there are smarter people beyond you. They hire smart people. They hire the smartest stat guy. They hire the smartest marketing person. They hire the smartest people. But sometimes the smartest people may not be able to take on some of this stuff. May not be able to make the best decision. That's a whole other skill. Making good decisions is a skill you gotta work on. And it comes with failure. And if you're afraid of failure, it won't make you be a good business person. Failure is a part of reality. It needs to be accepted, right? But if you're afraid because whatever reason, does somebody tell you a measure of success, I think, hey, who measures success for you, somebody else or you? Once again, the quality of your thoughts matter. Did you make that? I feel bad about that word. Somebody call me a bad word. You do not. You control your reaction. That word may not mean nothing. The point is, focus on what's in your control and stop focusing on what's out of your control. A lot of things are not in your control. Don't focus on those things. Only focus on what you actually have to. I'll end off here, there, but any other questions? Well, S corps and C corps are distinct instances, right? Yeah, and it's the sort of pass through with that because. S-corps make it double tax because they potentially pay dividends, most dividends tax. Right, so S-corps could potentially be more for like investment companies that give back dividends, which means they give back a little bit of earnings to the people. So you're going to pay tax as a company. Also, the shareholders, the dividend. So C Corp and X Corp really depends on what kind of business are you starting. Right? Yeah, taxes going in. I mean, you look on like the stock market, a lot of them are C Corps, right? They're not the double taxation. Or they don't pay dividends. So it depends on what they're doing. Like they hold the money. Yes, our money, we make a lot of money. We're not giving the money out to people directly, right? And then LLCs, I'm pretty familiar with those. I mean, LLCs are the best. Most of the stuff I do is LLCs. If you own properties, probably, if you own multiple properties, each one should be its own company. So I have like kind of LLCs for different properties. Why? To separate the liability from one to the next. This one has nothing to do with this one. So yeah, if you start a business, you don't want a business in your name. Never start a business and have it in your name. You're liable to be sued, and guess what? You, with your social security number, will be sued. You got it in the company? No. You, with your employment ID and the number, will be sued. They got nothing to do with you. You'd be a gazillionaire. I can't touch anyone. That's something different. So it's just liability. Okay? That's all I said. And taxes. All right, I'll keep you guys. I mean, I'll let you go. And I'll see you on Tuesday. Be prepared for Tuesday. Talk.